Alrighty, so we're going to start covering phase three general, starting from chapter one. Okay, so now when you look at your notes, if you are by any chance, I will refer to all of the content first and then we can answer any questions you have along the way.
I'm looking at the textbook. Should I be looking at the other notes?
Yeah, you should be looking at the notes to make it easier for you.
The ones that you sent me, okay.
Cool. The notes are condensed and they will describe exactly what we're trying to focus on for exam study purposes.
Okay.
What you want to do is learn these notes, learn this this information first. You can go back and read the book more as a magazine, per se, because okay. You can utilize these notes to really give you the foundation of understanding of what's going to be on the exam.
Okay.
So first of all, it's going to talk about contract. It's a contract, as you know, is going to be legally binding between two people who are signing off and also that they're competent, right? So we want to make sure it's a lawful contract. It's between two parties that are basically sober and in a mental capacity to make the deal and read the details and understand the English and have the ability to read. It should be a lawful agreement in all aspects. You can't make an agreement against the law saying, well, you signed it, tough luck. But if it's illegal, it's already void. If the people are not healthy or not at full capacity at the time, it's already void again. There's another situation if you sign a contract between a husband and a wife. So let's say you're married, Kyle, and your wife's in Texas. She flies back after you signed an agreement to buy a house, but she decides not to sign. That agreement becomes null and void too in that same situation. Okay. So, and there has to be obviously consideration. So there has to be an exchange of goodwill. So I would, if I wanted to rent your place, I would give you a deposit, some check or bank draft or cash, and you would give me a receipt for it so that we could have an arrangement to proceed with a contract between the two of us. But there has to be something that is going to act as consideration. All of the terms in the agreement that are in a contract have to be pretty clear. So you have to be able to understand them. I can't write them in some kind of lingo that makes no sense. If you and I are going to do a contract, you have to be able to understand clearly what the terms and conditions mean. So there's no real misconception, okay? Missing elements, if there's anything obviously missing from the contract that should have been in there, it's going to also make the contract void if it goes to court. Like in most cases, if you wrote a contract and you missed a couple of points that were a part of it, it's going to actually allow the judge to say, you know what, I'm going to throw it right out. Okay? So I've already covered point one, two, one and two for capacity. So you can't be illiterate, mentally incompetent, you can't be intoxicated, and you can't be under some kind of substance that doesn't allow you to make the appropriate decision. Corporations, they need a signing officer, so only the person who's on the articles of corporation, he's the only person that can sign. So somebody can't sign at a company saying, well, I work there.
Right, yeah.
That doesn't apply. That's okay. It's not going to fly. If there's a partnership, there should be one of the partners who's usually can make it binding. So if one of the both the partners do both the banking, one of those partners signing is going to be fully acceptable. Okay? So we've already covered a lawful object. It's got to be completely legal. It can't be contradictory to the laws or the tax laws or any criminal code that's out there. Okay? So consideration is the value, which will be the sum of money, which we just discussed. As long as that's provided with the contract. So if I write you a contract to say, here's a contract, but I'm going to give you a deposit on Friday, that contract's going to come into effect when I give you that deposit on Friday.
Okay.
So if I never show up with a deposit, that contract really doesn't hold over. There's no goodwill. There's no consideration, as they call it in the book.
Right. Okay.
So now when we go to make an agreement, it's obviously for the mutual benefit of everyone and it's for the mutual agreement. Not necessarily always for a benefit, but it's definitely for the mutual agreement of both the parties.
Okay.
So upon acceptance, you've already decided to follow all of the terms and conditions that are in that agreement. Naturally, before signing an agreement, you want to have a genuine intention. So if my intention was to sign a lease to make sure you didn't lease it to someone else and then I never gave you consideration, you could be pretty ticked off at me.
Yeah.
You could come back at me if you saw me that I was just really trying to tie up your lease so I could do my own lease on the same street. That's right. A terrible way of doing things, but those things can occur and those things can pop up in business. And the genuine intention is actually an important factor, because if you can prove that that person was doing something against the intention of you succeeding and also misrepresentation during that time, it's almost considered fraud in that case. Mm-hmm. Okay. So if you look down here, it says there's improper means of genuine intention for them. One could be a common mistake. Somebody was unaware of something. So say, for example, you said, I want to, you know, lease this property today. And then you find out right in front they're going to be doing some kind of demolition company, which is going to, the noise is out of whack for you, which, you know, you can't handle. So that could be a common mistake. You weren't sure or you weren't aware of what was going on in front of you. There could be a mutual mistake where you both could have misunderstood each other on a certain wavelength. Unilateral mistake could be when one of the parties is at a mistake and then the other one is kind of aware of it.
Okay.
So a mix of the two. Okay. Misrepresentation is going to be a completely false statement. So misrepresentation is where I'll tell you something different, but do something different. Right? So there could be an innocent one where it could be, I, you know, totally didn't mean to do that. It could be, there could still be damages that are going to be allocated to the party that suffered, even if it's a mistake.
Okay.
But it wasn't intentional. So you, there could also be a fraudulent version of that where you've done it on purpose. And then, of course, that's misrepresentation on a whole different scale. And that could involve enforcement. That could involve recovery of damages. Could involve a lot of things. Okay? Negligence is just something you forgot or you made a mistake for. Or it could just be untrue. And you weren't sure because you didn't even study it. So because you didn't know, you weren't sure, whatever the case is, it's going to be a problem either way. Okay? Tort liability is if you're in breach of a duty involving like a civil wrong. So basically it's where the common law will give damages, it's compensation, but no punishment. So, you know, I told you I was going to lease you a place, then I decided to give it to my brother, and you're all you know, all over the place now because you had other plans, you hired the moving truck. Now I've got to give you compensation, but there's no punishment related to that fact.
Okay.
And you're going to commonly see in a lot of real estate transactions where there's misrepresentation, there's usually just compensation, not really a punishment.
Okay.
Unless it's some kind of next degree of fraud.
Yeah.
Okay? Like mortgage fraud or something like that. That will have punishment attached to it. Undue influence, so that's distress, involves threat or violence. You got very angry at one of your clients. They said they were going to lease the place. They decided not to at the last minute. And now your landlord wants to, you know, tell you to reduce your fees or whatever the case is. So it's a domino effect of all these problems occurring. And if there is distress or duress pronounced, if you have threat or violence involved in it, that's basically another situation. So failure to disclose, you don't want to do because that's already part of our REBA 2002 laws, right? We're obligated to disclose actually everything honestly and represent things completely clearly to all the parties that we're working for. Failure to disclose is a non-disclosure. So that can also invalidate your contract as well.
Okay.
So now there's another item called the material latent defect. And that's basically if something is not working properly or it's unfit for use. So if you you know, made a basement apartment and all of a sudden the pipes burst and now it's full of water, it's not it's not fit for living anymore.
Right.
So in that case, you might be liable for hotel charges, damages, depends on the situation, but
right.
It all depends who's caused and what happened, what transpired in that case. So there's obviously a big, it goes into saying there's a concern with local authorities or lack of appropriate building or permits, because sometimes a basement apartment obviously is not legal and has no permits, so anything that happens there can actually lead to other issues with the city getting involved too,
okay,
which you want to avoid. So definite and clear, all the terms in the contract, like I said, have to be very definite and very clear, so they make sense and there's no issue with people understanding what they're signing. Termination of the contract is a mutual agreement. So say you and I decide to not sell our houses anymore together, and we agree, we sign off on the documents that say mutually we'll release each other from the transaction. We can just go about our business after that. Now by performance, it covers when the contract's completed. So it's when the sale is basically closed. So the termination of the contract's already happened if the deal is closed. There's no more contract that exists.
Okay.
So all of the things that were in the contract have already been fulfilled, and it's done. It's done deal. It's over. So by impossibility of performance, that's if there's someone dies or the property, you know, is taken away by a fire or a storm or whatever the case is, then that could be the contract just terminating automatically, because now if you made a contract to buy a property and it doesn't exist there anymore, there's no contract. Operation by law is just a court order. If the court orders it, basically if the person, say, they're fraudulent or they're a criminal or they've done something to obtain the property that's not right, a court order will step in and terminate the contract if you're trying to buy it off someone else who doesn't technically own it.
Okay.
Okay. Breach of contract. So if one party fails to fulfill their duties on the side of the contract, there could be a way out of termination to get out of that contract in that case. So if you're buying a house and the guy says, I'm going to do all the floors for you, and he doesn't, breach of contract. So you could most likely in that case get out of that contract very easily through your solicitor.
Okay.
So remedies for breach of contract. So let's look at the remedies. There's five of them. The first one is rescission. It's setting up aside a contract to revoke it or cancel it. So you're already setting aside a separate contract to say, we're going to be canceling this contract. Okay. Damages, financial compensation. So there's no punishment, obviously, in this one. You said you were going to do the floors. You didn't do them. And I'll say, okay, you know what, Kyle? I'll take $10,000 cash for the floors. I'll get them done myself. Then we've got quantum merit. This one is fantastic because it's a reasonable amount for partial work performed. This is determined by the court. So let's say that you said, well, you know, I said I was going to do all the flooring, but I did do the main floor and the basement.
Yeah.
I wasn't able to reach up to the second floor because of the time constraint. So the court will say, you know what, we're going to give you the allocation of money of the work that you performed, and all you're actually liable for is the second floor compensation. So it's fair, right? And then the number four is for like an exact performance. So it's very particular. So that's according to the discretion of the courts. That's basically where whatever you promised wasn't delivered, and the damages are not still adequate to remedy the situation. So that can be very costly in that case. So things weren't better because you said, here's an alternate solution. It didn't change anything. So the courts are saying, that's not going to cut it. You're going to still have to pay more.
Okay.
Then we got number five, which is an injunction. So stopping the breach party from continuing to breach. So you're refraining from doing something. So if I said to you, hey, Kyle, you can't take the fence down. I want the fence there. I never said you could take the fence down. So I get a court order or I get sheriff or whatever I do, get involved legally, and I have you stop doing the takedown of that fence, for example. So whatever it is you're doing, I just want you to stop doing it. It's already a breach, but I need you to stop doing it so it doesn't get worse. Because I don't even know if you can remedy it sometimes, right? So we can't determine that in certain occasions. Okay, so now we're at contract documents. So they're pre-printed forms and schedules usually done by AREA, as you know. We learned that obviously early. So let's look at a parole evidence rule. So this means that implies to a written agreement that can be modified in writing, alterations, amendments, variations should be in writing and should never be verbal. So in real estate, we don't ever do anything verbal, ever.
Right.
Okay? So in the contract, if he says, Kyle, can you put in there that you would get this house professionally cleaned by a professional cleaner before I move in? You're going to put that in writing, and you're going to put it, you know what, I will get it professionally cleaned by a professional cleaner. I'll put that in writing, and I'll also put in writing just to protect myself. The amount of money to be charged or the amount of funding that I'll provide won't exceed $150.
Okay.
So you want to protect yourself is my example in this case.
Yeah.
So you just don't want to empty write promises that you think you should start fulfilling because someone's asked you to. You want to put a limit or a cap on things because you know that you're going to be tied down to that agreement because you just signed for it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So you want to avoid that situation. Privity. So only parties in a contract can enforce what's binding. So let's take the example here. Purchase of sale agreement. The brokerage is only the witness. So the two parties are the ones that are actually in the contract. The brokerage may sue separately for providing misleading info. So if the two parties are in a conflict and the broker didn't do anything or has nothing to do with it, he can come and sue on top of it and say, oh, there's this issue and that issue. Okay?
Okay.
Statute of frauds. So certain things in the contract that are relating to the real estate must be in writing or enforceable by law. So the statute of frauds is basically saying that everything that you've written and done must be enforceable by law, so it has to be legal. So you can't say, hey, Mark, I'm going to sell you a house, but on the ownership, I'm still going to keep 25% just for the sake of it.
Okay.
That's illegal. You can't do that. Okay. So the doctrine of part performance is when you modify the statute of frauds for verbal contracts relating to the land, for example. So you performed a part of a bargain and, you know, just a conversation style, and then the contract clearly exists, and it also, if a party suffers a loss, they can be compensated. So let's just say you own a farm. I walked down the land. I said, hey, man, can you sell me 2 acres on the corner? And you said, you know what? Sure, I'll sell you 2 acres. So I go and buy some equipment for $500,000, and you back out from our verbal deal. I'll take you to court and say, well, I bought all the equipment based on the fact you told me that you were selling me the 2 acres of land.
Mm-hmm.
Something like that.
Okay.
Okay, something like that. So representation agreements, just says here's an oral or written agreement where owner appoints a brokerage for a specific period of time, lease or exchange, with the compensation, which is the commission. REBA 2002 does not require a signed representation agreement, but requires the registrant to prepare the same presentation to the party. So if you came into my house, did the commission presentation, but we didn't sign the agreement, but I verbally said sure, you can still take me to court for a commission.
Really?
Really.
What's to stop them from just saying we didn't say sure?
Well, it's if you were in the agreement. So luckily, hopefully you would have taken somebody with you, or you would have emailed them something later, or you would have...
You have to have some proof.
Probably take somebody with you, like another team member would be a good idea.
Okay.
If you feel someone you're going to meet is not going to sign the document, and that's going to be an issue, but if you go to court and say there's a verbal agreement and you can have someone testify or a witness, that would be helpful. Okay. Hearsay is tough. Hearsay is really tough. But if you get a statement from the buyer that bought the house and saying, yeah, I saw the house with Kyle before, and they agreed, and they said, we want to cut him out, perfect. You got yourself a written statement from that. Even if it's an email, even if it's a text message, you know that's going to work for you.
Some kind of tangible proof.
Some kind of tangible proof.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm just going to put an end to our chapter one right now.